JazakumAllah khair, everyone joining us for this very important lesson of Fiqh. We are, bi-idhnillahi azza wa jalla, going to cover the chapter of the funeral prayer, the Janazah, which entails the washing of the body, the shrouding of the body, the Janazah salah over the body, and eventually the burial of the dead body. And of course, for the body that's going to be buried, in terms of how it should be buried, the digging of the grave, what shape it should be, also in terms of masail, the rules and regulations of following the dead body until the graveyard, the rewards therein, and the adab of it. It's quite a long chapter in comparison to our normal lessons, and so may Allah give us energy and focus so that we can swiftly cover it in one go. We start from page number 119 of our book, Ascent to Felicity, Maraq al-Sa'adat, Mu'ilmay al-Tawheed wal-Ibadat, by Al-Imam Abu al-Ikhlas al-Shurum Mulari, which has been translated by Faraz Ahmad Khan. Page number 119, the funeral prayer, Janazah and burial. Of course, prior to this, we covered the Salat al-Khawf and Salat al-Khusuf and Khusuf. There was one brother that asked me a question about the Sajda al-Shukr without wudu. Do you need wudu or not? And he's not here, so when he comes, inshallah, I'll answer that question. Moving on to our chapter now. The funeral prayer, Janazah and burial, it is sunnah to direct the person on his deathbed. So now we're starting just before the death, just before the person is dying. The muhtada, the person upon whom sakarat al-maut is happening, death is imminent, and he's suffering those last moments. It is sunnah, okay, 4, 3, 5, that as long as it is not difficult, it is not too difficult for the person. So if it is not too difficult for the person who is in the situation who is about to pass away, it is sunnah preferred, it's a prophetic tradition to try to direct the person on his deathbed towards the Qibla, either by facing him toward the right hand side, so that way, or by, if he is facing forward towards the Qibla, by slightly lifting his head with a pillow so that he is facing the Qibla. In any case, to face his head towards the Qibla is considered to be sunnah for the muhtada, the person who is facing sakarat and in his last moments of life, such that he faces it while on his right side, It is also permissible, however, to do so while he's lying on his back with his feet directed toward the Qibla, yet his head should be slightly raised with something like a pillow so that he is facing the Qibla. That's the sunnah in terms of his positioning. Then the shahada, positioning is as we've described. Then the shahada should be recited in his presence, which is Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah, so that he may pronounce it too. The shahada should be recited in his presence, not instructing him, but it should be recited in his presence so that he can pronounce it too. This is referred to as talqin, and it is also performed after his burial. When the person dies, his jaws, before we go to the next part, 4374 says, talqin of the person on his deathbed is recommended. So if someone is in his last moments, we should say, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, Ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah, quietly in a calm voice without instructing him, say, you just say it, and he gets encouraged by overhearing your recitation of it. So that his final words before death are, La ilaha illallah. He should not be commanded to recite it, rather, he should be merely reciting in his presence and in a gentle manner as he is already in a difficult state. As to its performance for the deceased after the burial, should you still say talqin or Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah or La ilaha illallah to encourage the person after his burying is finished, there is a difference of opinion among the Hanafi scholars. The author maintained that it is legislated and should therefore be performed at the very least. If done by some, it should not be denounced by others as there is a benefit in it for the deceased person. Generally, for you to do the talqeen for the person who is on their deathbed is accepted, is recommended, and you should do it. As for after the death of the person, after the person is deceased, passed away, should you carry on after he's been buried to encourage him even then? That's a difference of opinion. Generally, there is no need. It is better for you to make dua for him. It is better for you to do salaqat for him. It is better for you to do dua for him and to ask Allah to forgive him and give him Jannah to Firdaus and make his questioning easy. So now we said positioning as such. What you say, as you describe. Then the person, when he actually passes away, when he dies, his jaws should be closed for him and fastened so that they don't get open again. So we should try to close his jaws, and it should be kept closed. So if it closes by itself, it should just remain as such. So generally, to make sure that his mouth is closed and fastened, and his eyes should also be shut by the person next to him. The one closing his eyes should say. So when you're closing the eyes, because not always does a person passing away close their eyes by themselves, sometimes slightly open, sometimes fully open. And so when the person passes away, he has no control over his eyelids. Now you have to close their eyelids for him. And so the person who is closing his eyelids for him should say, in the name of Allah, and on the way, in the way of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, oh Allah, make his affairs smooth for him, ease for him, that which is to follow, make him happy by his meeting you, and make that which has gone off to be better than what, and make that which he has gone off to better than that which he has left behind. Page 197 says the Arabic of that dua. I'm going to read in Arabic as well, so you know, because some of the duas, because they're longer at the end. And it says here, the dua is Bismillah wa ala millati Rasulillah, Allahumma yassir alayhi amrahu wa sahil alayhi ma ba'dahu wa as'idhu bi liqa'ika waj'al ma kharaja ilayhi khayran mimma kharaja anhu. This is the dua that should be recited by the person who's closing the eyelids of the person who's just passed away. Next, his nakedness should be covered, meaning you should make sure that if he was somehow he became uncovered, he is now covered. Now that he's finished, he's calmed, and he's fixed and he's still, you should cover his awrah for him. 438 says, that is from the navel to the knees, although according to other opinion, covering the private parts alone suffices, meaning that you should cover the awrah of the person depending on the gender. So if it's a man, then at the very least, from his navel to his knees, including his navel, including his knees. If it's a woman, then everything in her body except for her face and her hands are allowed to be uncovered. And so therefore, for her, just after their death, is to be covered. The rest of his clothes are then removed. Of course, now, if you are waiting for the washing to happen, then the awrah is covered. Now, when it comes to the washing of the body itself, at some point, this awrah is also going to have to be exposed because of the washing itself. But generally, we should try to cover the private parts of both the male and female throughout. And so even if it needs to be washed, it should be for only a temporary period of time, not to leave it exposed for a long time for the entire washing. And so next is nakedness, awrah should be covered. Then the rest of his clothes are then removed, and he is given wudu except for the rinsing of the mouth and the nose. So now this is the beginning of the washing of the person, the dead body. First he is given wudu, just like you would wash your face, he'd wash his arms, he'd wash his feet, he'd wipe his head, etc. Except for the mouth and nose, because these are now closed, and we don't put any more water in there, because you'll not be able to take it out. And so, that's the system that we just wash there, we give them wudu, because generally ghusl, in any ghusl, sunnah is to do wudu first. That's something that we covered in the chapter of ghusl as well. Whenever you do ghusl, if you want to do it the sunnah way, you should do wudu first, then you should commence in your ghusl, which is the bathing. Then the entire body will be washed. A ghusl of ideally three complete washes to fulfill the sunnah. So after the person is now, he has been given wudu, the ghusl will commence, and it will comprise of three complete washes of the body. One from the right, one from the left, and then another one of the whole body. We'll explain now. With water and if possible, lotus tree leaves, siddin, or the like, otherwise warm water alone suffices. Meaning, the water that's being used to wash the body should be warm. It should also be slightly fragranced with something like lotus tree leaves, which is called siddin in Arabic. Before the ghusl, however, his beard and hair are washed with mallow leaves, which is called khitmi, or any other type of soap. So you are allowed to wash the person's hair and their beard with some sort of soap before actually commencing with the washing, so that if there's any extra dirt, that's taken off. Because of course hair is generally a bit more sticky, a bit more greasy, and so to use soap on that is allowed and you should. Next, when actually performing the ghusl, the body is, so just before that we said, the entire body will be washed with something, with warm water, lotus tree leaves, siddin, or the like, otherwise warm water alone is fine. But before the ghusl, before the actual washing itself, the hair of the head and the beard are also to be washed separately another time with soap or something similar to it, so as to remove the grease and any other extra dirt. The body is washed from its right side first, so now what happens, followed by the left, thus comprising the first two washes. 439 says, as the author mentions in Imdad, the body is first placed on his left hand side for the first complete wash. So now, of course, we're supposed to start the wash from the right-hand side first, as we do with wudu and as we do with our normal ghusl. Also, the deceased person's body is to be washed from the right-hand side. How do we do that? The body is tilted to the left-hand side, on the left-hand side of his body, and from there, water is passed across the body with, of course, whoever is doing the bathing.
it's one person or two persons, and the water is then rubbed until an entire wash is done, meaning water reaches every part of their body, starting from the right hand side. That's considered to be the first wash from the right hand side. He is then made to sit up, that's comprising, and then from the same thing on the left. So now the body is tilted to the right hand side, and a second wash from the left hand side. So that's now completed, two complete washes, first from the right, second one from the left. He is then made to sit up, and his abdomen is gently wiped to remove any of its contents. So here, any of his contents, this, if there is anything there remaining, that should be also taken out. Thereafter, the pure water is poured over his body for the third time, for the final wash, for the final ghusl. Thereafter, after the second wash, the third wash commences. And in terms of how the third wash happens, 440 says to us, both the Arabic published edition and the manuscript before that affair. Yet what is meant, as mentioned by the author himself in Imdad al-Fatah, is that the body is laid on its left hand side once again for a third complete wash. So the first wash was on the left hand side, the second wash was on the body was leaning on its right hand side, and now for the third and final wash, again you do it, you tip the body towards the other side, and you do it on the right hand side again. So you started with the right and you finish with the right side also. In total, we have now completed three washes of the body. The body is then dried with the cloth, his hair should not be combed, and his nails should not be trimmed. The funeral shrouds should be perfumed with incense an odd number of times, and then wrapped around the body. A mixture of fragrant substances like harut is placed on his hair and his beard, and come four on his feet, knees, hands, forehead, and nose, be massaged the limbs upon which that he used to do his sujood on to one of them. And so some sort of a perfume is applied on his forehead, okay, on his nose, on his knees, and on his feet, these part, and his hands, where he used to do sujood with, in order to honor them. The man's funeral shrouds, according to the sunnah, now come to how do we do the kafan itself. We've spoken about before death, we've spoken about how to wash the body, now we're speaking about how to do the kafan, the sharding, the clothing of the deceased person, how it's done. Now, this is where it's different from the man and the woman. So far, in terms of washing, it was more or less similar. In terms of shrouding, it's slightly different. In terms of shrouding, there are three stages, there are three levels. There is one called kafan al-sunnah, the amount which is preferred, which is recommended, which is the best, which is the most rewarding. Okay, and that's more cloths, in terms of how many cloths are used. Then there's something called kafan al-kifaya, kafan al-kifaya, which is just about enough. And then there is something called kafan al-darura, the amount of kafan which is in a state of extreme necessity, where there is no other clothes available, for example, in the state of a journey, for example, in the midst of a warfare, and etc. So kafan can be of three different levels, right? And so the optimum and the best is kafan al-sunnah. The man's funeral shroud, according to sunnah, kafan al-sunnah, consists of a long shirt, a qamis, and an inner shroud called izar, and an outer shroud called lifafa. Okay? So he has a long shirt, a qamis, that goes over his body. Then he has something called an izar, which is the lower garment. And then he has an overshroud called a lifafa. These are the three garments required, shrouds required for a man for it to be kafan of sunnah. As for kafan of kifaya, meaning the amount, that's okay. Meaning it's not the full, it's not the optimum, it's not the best, but it's still okay. Then it's just the two shrouds, which is the top and the bottom, okay? And if there is a necessity where there is no other clothes available because you're in the middle of nowhere, or the person is extremely poor, he has no clothes with him to cover it, then as much as is available in terms of clothing to cover the person, as you know, from the Sahaba, they were in the battlefield, some of them, there was not enough clothes to cover their entire body. And so if they were to cover their feet, their head would be exposed, and if their head was covered, their feet would be exposed. So this also goes to show the difficulty the Sahaba went through, but also shows that this is also permissible, because the Prophet ﷺ did bury them in that way. So the funeral shrouds, according to the sunnah, kafan sunnah, consists of a long shirt, a qamis, an inner shroud, an izar, and an outer shroud, a lifafa, all preferably taken from the quality and standard that which he would wear in his lifetime for the Friday or Eid prayers, meaning the clothing that you're using, the kafan, doesn't have to be one same condition or one same type. It should be according to the person's ability. Shrouds made from white cotton are most preferred. Both the inner and outer shrouds should cover the body from the top of the head to the bottom of the feet. Both the inner and outer shrouds for the man should cover the body from the top of the head to the bottom of the feet. 441 says, yet with the outer shroud being a little longer so as to facilitate to try to tie in the shrouds, because we know that the both the shroud is tied at the end, towards the end, on the towards the feet side and the head side. And so the inner shroud and the outer shroud. Inner shroud should be slightly smaller and the outer shroud should be slightly bigger, but ultimately both of them covering the entire body from the head to the toe. Both the inner and outer shroud should cover the body from the top of the head to the bottom of the feet. The long shirt, which is the qamis, should not have any sleeves or opening at the neck, and its ends should not be hemmed, meaning stitched. So it's called a qamis, and qamis is a similar word to any shirt that you use in life. So this is also a qamis. What you're wearing now are called qamis, okay? It means shirt generally. And so it might be assumed that because qamis is used here, that it should be like a normal stitched qamis, but this is not like that kind of a qamis. This is a shroud qamis, and so there is no stitching, there is no hemming, there is no opening. It's just simply another piece of shroud that's used, but it's called a qamis. Okay, it is disliked to place a turban on the head of the deceased person. The inner shroud is wrapped first from the left side, then from the right side. If it is feared that the shroud will open up the burial site is far, for example, then they should be tied. So how do we now, we've got all of these three pieces of clothing, what happens, how are they used, how are they used to be buried, burying the person? He says that the inner shroud is wrapped first, it's around the body first, from the left side, then the right side, so the right side is on top. The right side, the closing side should be on top, the left side is at the bottom. If it is feared that the shroud will open up by the time he gets to the graveyard, it's also allowed for it to be tied on either sides. The inner and outer shrouds alone are sufficient to fulfill the obligation of a man, for kafan al kifaya. Like I said before, the qamis is to complete the sunnah, which is a shorter inner garment, right? But if it is just the outer and inner shroud, the izar and the lifafa, they are also sufficient for the person, for his shroud, for his kafan to be kafan al kifaya, which is the enough amount. Now we come to the woman's kafan. That was all the man. The woman's kafan is different, is more in number, and again, this goes is coherent with the general concept of how much a woman covers her body in her lifetime, and also after her lifetime, we find that there's an emphasis on covering her hair more, also in terms of her chest area is also covered another time. And so this goes to show that there is more emphasis given on shrouding the woman. So we see the fulfilling. To fulfill the sunnah of woman's shrouds, kafan sunnah, the face should also be wrapped with a head covering called the khimar. So yes, the izar and the lifafa is also there, but additional khimar is also used to cover her head, and her breast should be wrapped, it should be tied with a separate cloth called a khirqa. For the minimally sufficient shroud, okay, so now that was, so now the woman has, how many things does she have? She has the normal, the inner garment, the outer garment, she has a khimar to cover her hair, she has a khirqa as an addition over her chest part, and so that is more than the man's. As for what's sufficient, just about enough for the woman, this is the sunnah, that's the optimum, that's the most rewarding. For the minimal sufficient shroud, kafan al-kifaya for women, the head covering is enough in addition to the two main shrouds. So the head covering plus the two main shrouds. Okay. Her hair is tied into two braids, which are placed on her chest above her long shirt, then the head covering above it, yet underneath the outer shroud. So the hair is tied into two braids, which are placed on her chest above the long shirt. So you have the qamis. So for the man, we have three pieces as sunnah. We have the qamis, the izar, and the lifafa. For the woman, we have the khimar, the head garment. Then we have the qamis. Then we have the izar. Then we have the lifafa. Then we have also the khirqa, which is for the chest area. So five pieces of cloths or garments are used for the woman. And so generally when her hair is now braided and tied, it is put on top of her chest, but on top of the qamis, the first piece of garment that's put on her body. And then now that's covered, that hair is now, it's over the qamis, but now it's going to be covered by the outer shroud. The inner shroud, the shrouds that come on top, that will cover the hair, Then the head covering above it, yet underneath the outer shroud. And lastly, extra cloth for her breast over her outer shroud. Now, the last piece of clothing for her chest part, it can be within, inside the outer shroud or outside. Some scholars have maintained that within, inside the outer shroud is preferred,
While others have said that even if it is completely outside the main shroud, as in the last thing that's apparent on a kafan, that's also permissible. And so there is no problem there. Now we come to the kafan al-darura, the bare minimum. There is no clothes available, there is no cloth. How much is required for either gender is based on whatever is available. However much of the body can be covered, and then they are buried, of course, after the funeral prayer. So now we've done muhtadar, talqeen, how to say shahada for them, what happens after they pass away, how to wash the body, how to shroud the body. Now we come to the janazah, the prayer itself. Okay? So the funeral prayer, that's what we see. That's what the general public see. We don't see all of this other stuff. Generally, this is all done in private. Of course, the person passes away at home, talqeen is done, washing is done in privacy. Now the janazah is what we all know, and so you see, that this is all famous. The funeral prayer janazah is a communal obligation. It's a fardu kifaya, meaning that if some people in the community do the janazah, then there is no sin on everybody else, meaning the job has been done. That the whole community has been safeguarded from any sort of sin. However, if no one in the community bothers to do the janazah of the person or bothers to dig a grave for the person, then the entire community is sinful. So even if one person does the responsibility, takes the responsibility, then the job is done and the sin is lifted from the entire community. The funeral prayer is a communal obligation, a fardhu kifaya. It is performed by saying in one's heart, and so the intention first. It's a salatul janazah, right? It's a salatul janazah, means dua, means prayer. And so every action, every ibadah has to have some sort of an intention at the beginning. The intention doesn't have to be uttered, it should be in the heart. And the intention is said, or in the heart, as follows: I intend to pray for the sake of Allah Most High and to supplicate for the deceased. Meaning you make the intention of praying janazah for this person, to make dua for them, and to pray to Allah Azza wa Jalla. The follower should also make the intention that I am praying behind an imam. So if the imam is there, he just makes the intention of praying. But if you are a follower, as in you are behind the imam, then you should also make the additional intention that you are behind an imam. One then says the first takbir. Okay, so now we've said the intention is there, how important it is. Okay, the deceased person is placed in front of the janazah prayer. Okay, and that's supposed to be dua for them. Not to get confused by anything else. It's not to bow to them. It's not to respect them in any way. It's to pray for them, and that is the way the Prophet ﷺ has taught us. Their body is placed in front, okay, with their. Okay, we'll come to that in a moment, inshallah. Then the first takbir to commence the prayer. Then the first takbir is made to commence the prayer. 447 says that this is the only takbir in which the hands are raised. All four takbirs are said aloud, while the closing salams are said quietly. Okay, there's one point that we missed, and I'm going to read that now before we come to the Salat of Janazah itself. It's very good. 445, it says, now it's mentioned to exactly how should you put the shroud. It was ambiguous. We learn about the different shrouds, but how do you do it? How do you wrap it up? It's not so, we haven't got a clear image of how we should wrap it up. And so this one I will explain to you. The ideal way to shroud the man is to spread out the outer shroud, meaning you get all of the shrouds. Get the biggest one, the outer shroud, and place it on the ground. Okay, nice and neat. Then the inner shroud, get the inner shroud and put it on top. So that the outer shroud is there, and the inner shroud is also on top, nicely opened up. Then the long shirt is laid on top of the, on top with the upper flap of it rolled up. Then the kameez is also put on the floor. Now all three of them are piled up. The outer shroud being the first one that you laid down, the inner shroud being the second one that you laid down, and the kameez, the inner garment, because the one that you laid down last is the first one that's going to touch the body, isn't it? That's now the inner garment. Okay. The body is placed on top of this arrangement. So the body is then simply carried gently and placed onto this piling, these three layers, on top of the arrangement. And first wrapped with the long shirt, then the kameez is placed over. So now this is the inner garment, isn't it? Because that was the last one that you put down. So the kameez is put there, long shirt, and then the inner shroud is wrapped around the body, left side first, so that the right side is on top. Generally we do right side first with everything, but here we put the left side in first so that the right side is on top. So preferability is still the right hand side in the sense that it's on top. Does that make sense? And that's the system, that's the way. Then the inner shroud is wrapped around the body, left side first, so that the right side is on top. Finally, the outer shroud is wrapped in the same manner, left side first. That's what happens. And then that's the kafan. If it needs to be carried somewhere, we are allowed to tie the ends. For the woman, the outer shroud and inner shroud are similarly spread. So now that was the man. For the woman, the outer shroud, then the inner shroud are placed on top of each other. The inner shroud is placed on top of the outer shroud, then the inner one above. Then the long shirt is then laid on top of the upper flap, with the upper flap of it rolled up. So the qamis is then placed as well on top of it. Okay. Before the two shrouds, inner and outer, are wrapped around her body, however, the khimar is placed. So now after putting the qamis on, like we've said before, her hair cover is also put on, is placed over her head and face, over her head and face, then the body, then both shrouds, inner and outer, are wrapped over the body, left side first, one at a time, like with the man, so that the right side is on top. Lastly, placed above the outer shroud is the khidqa, is used to tie her chest, left side first. Some scholars have maintained that it should be, that it is tied beneath the outer shroud, like we've said before. So that was exactly how you shroud. Obviously, probably thing that I wish I never have to do is quite scary. But if you do, you know, may Allah give us all the strength and stability to remember, it may come a time when you have to do this. In fact, it probably will, most likely will. Some point, someone, of course, death is a fact. And so someone close to you might be needing the help of bathing and shrouding. And so to know this is very important. It's not common knowledge. So it's good that we are covering, alhamdulillah. Okay, so now we come back to the janazah. Okay, so the person has made the intention. Now the first takbir, Allahu Akbar, is said, and the hands are raised just like any salah, and then they are folded just like any salah. Okay. Then after the first tying of the hand, the first Allahu Akbar, sorry, after you've tied your hand, what you read in the beginning of every salah is Subhanakallah. Subhanakallah wa bihamdika wa tabaraka ismuka wa ta'ala jadduka wa la ilaha ghayruk. Surah Al-Fatiha, this is the opinion of Al-Imam Al-Shafi'i and those who followed him, that Surah Al-Fatiha should also be recited at this point. But the Ahnaf have maintained, the Hanafi Jews have said that you are allowed to read Surah Al-Fatiha only as a dua, not as Quran, because this salah is different from every other salah. This is more like a prayer, a supplication. And so they maintain that Subhanakallah alone is enough. Should you recite Surah Al-Fatiha, you should be with the intention of a dua, not to recite Quran just like you do in every other salah, because this is not like every other salah. Okay? So in any case, Surah Al-Fatiha is there. It has its place, okay? And you can recite it. And if you want to, you should recite it. And so no difference of opinion there in that sense, to finish the difference of opinion there. Okay, so although it is permissible to recite Surah Al-Fatiha, like he said here, he then makes a second takbir. So a first takbir, Subhanakallahumma, Surah Al-Fatiha is only if you want to. Okay? Then the second takbir. In the second takbir, there's no raising of the hand. Just Allahu Akbar. After which he says blessing upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in which is Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad, Allahu barik ala Muhammad wa ala ali, until the end of the normal, the salutation that you know in your tashahhud. That's what he said. Then he makes a third takbir. And after the third takbir, he should make dua for forgiveness of the deceased person and for the forgiveness of himself and for the amwat that have passed away, the deceased people that have passed away before. And so he says, oh Allah, forgive him and have mercy upon him. Oh Allah, give him well-being and pardon him, honor him in his place of residence. Oh Allah, make his entrance expansive as a big. Wash him with water, ice and snow, purify him from his sin, just like a white garment is purified from filth. Replace the above with the better one, his family with the better one, and his spouse with the better one. Enter him to paradise and save him from the punishment of the grave and of the fire. You might be thinking, replace him with a better family, with a better spouse, what's he talking about? Imam Ibn Abidin, he explains this point. He says, better family and better wife doesn't mean a different one. It means that, oh Allah, give him his family, but give them better qualities. If they have any bad qualities, replace them with better qualities. If someone's got a bad feature, increase it to be better. That's what he has maintained, so as to show that it's completely coherent, that you can, that your family is with you in Jannah as long as they follow you in good deeds. Khalas? As in they carry on living as a Muslim. And die as a Muslim, inshallah, azza wa jalla. And so, that's the dua. The Arabic of it, we should say it as well, we should practice it, we should read it. 197 again. It says, Allahumma ighfir lahu warhamhu wa'afihi wa'fu anhu. In fact, this is dua you should also make for someone when you hear about someone passing away. If someone says, oh, my uncle is passed away, you say, inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. And also you make dua for him. This dua, you can send it to him, or you can write it for him, or you can read it out generally. You don't have to let him know that you've read it for him even. اللهم اغفر له وارحمه وعافه واعف عنه أكرم منزله ووسع مدخله واغسله بالماء والثلج والبرد ونقيه من الخطايا كما ينقى الثوب الأبيض من الدنس وأبدله دارا خيرا من داره وأهلا خيرا من أهله وزوجا خيرا من زوجه وأدخله الجنة وأعزه وأعزه وسوري وأعيذ من عذاب القبر وعذاب النار فاستدعاني من السبع. We can also read اللهم اغفر لحينا وميتنا وشاهدنا وغائبنا وصغيرنا وكبيرنا وذكرنا وأنثانا اللهم من أحييته منا فأحيا على الإسلام والتوحيد منا فتوفي على الإيمان. This is all after the third takbir. There's a fourth takbir. What do you do after the fourth takbir? You're allowed to make a short dua, but also you can just do salam. Generally, it's just a salam. After the fourth takbir, Allahu Akbar, Rasul, Allahu Akbar, Assalamu alaikum, Assalamu alaikum, Assalamu alaikum, wa rahmatullah, just one salam, and it's then quiet. Okay. He then says the fourth takbir followed by the closing two salams. One does not seek forgiveness for the janazah prayer of a deceased child or insane person. This is very interesting. In terms of forgiveness, you ask the du'as of forgiveness if the deceased person for whom you're praying the janazah is an adult, because they can have sin. What if the person that's passed away is a child or a mad person? They have no sins. A person who's mentally unwell, they have no control over their actions, and so they are innocent. Similarly, a child is not responsible for his actions until he becomes balig. And so for them we say, Allahumma ja'alhu lana faratan wa ja'alhu lana ajran wa dhukhra wa ja'alhu lana shafi'an wa mushafi'an, means, wallah, make him one who is sent forth from us on our behalf, as well as a reward and stored treasure for us. Make him an intercessor for us and accept his intercession for us. Meaning, he is sinless, and so we don't necessarily have to make dua for his forgiveness, because he's already sinless. Okay. If the deceased is buried without a funeral prayer, now we've said how the janazah is done. Now we're supposing that for some reason someone is buried without a janazah, because they didn't know, non-Muslims just buried him, and etc. And so, or for example, he drowned somewhere, or etc. And there was his janazah was not done in his presence. Or generally, he was buried without a janazah for some reason. If the deceased was buried without a funeral prayer, then it is to be performed over his grave unless the body is disintegrated, which is only known by estimation. So if he died recently, then it can be done next to his grave as his janazah, as he is present there in that sense. Not to, again, clarification, not to prostrate to a grave, not to worship a grave, as his janazah, which is due upon him, which he is old, his janazah prayer. Does that make sense? So not to say that, oh, we'll be to whatever, all this nonsense that some people come up with. The funeral prayer is performed over a miscarried fetus as well, so if most of it came out while it is alive. So now we have said, an alive person if he was an adult, an alive person if he was a child, if he passed away, what happens? An alive person if he died and the janazah wasn't done, what do you do? Now we're saying a child. We've also said what happens to a child and a mental person in terms of what dua you make for them. You do their janazah, what dua you make for them. What about the fetus, the newborn baby, which was born dead? You do janazah, do you name it, does it inherit, do you inherit from it? All of these rules come in.